Hello, my name is Alex Matthews. I'm one of the IPM specialists at Fargrow, and today I'm going to be talking you through controlling spider mites with the use of biologicals. Within this presentation, I'm going to go through briefly identification of the pests within the crop, looking at life cycles, and also individual biologicals that are available to create an effective IPM strategy for controlling this pest. So, very briefly, we'll look over the identification of spider mites and how to spot them in the crop. On the right-hand side, you can see the spider mite adults. So the adults are around 0.75 mil in length. The larvae are around 0.3 mil in length. They vary in colour depending on species and also what they're feeding on, so the crop type. They create this distinctive speckling on the leaf damage. So this is created from the spider mites biting into the leaf surface and sucking out the contents of the cells, which creates this yellowing, speckled yellowing across the crop, which grows as the colonies expand. The distinct webbing on the left-hand side, on the left-hand picture, is really a key indicator and an indicator of a stage that you really don't want to reach. So you can see the adults crawling across the webbing. This creates a real issue at this stage for the biologicals as well as the spray program. So for the biologicals, it can create an issue for species, predatory species such as Amblyseus, difficulty in crawling across this webbing. And also for a spray program, it can be quite difficult to penetrate through the spray to actually reach the colonies and have an effective control. So it's really important that the preventative measures are carried out before you reach this stage. So you're putting in your biologicals early as the spider mites are still in or coming out of diapause, so before this webbing stage. So, looking very briefly over the life cycle of spider mite. Firstly, the egg, which is small, spherical, and generally found on the underside of the leaf, suspended in the webbing. This is then followed by a larval stage, two nymph stages. So, you've got the protonymph and the deuteronymph, then finally the adult. The damaging stages of the spider mite are the larvae, nymph stages, and the adult. So, these stages are also where to get to each growth stage, the spider mite itself will undergo a shedding phase, so skin shedding. So this is often where you'll find empty skin present within the crop. So looking at the diapause microcolonies, these are generally made up of mated females. However, there are also males present within these microcolonies. As you can see in the foreground, that is a spider mite male. These turn orange in response to and enter diapause in response to factors such as reducing temperatures, reducing day lengths, and also reduced plant nutrition. So this is over the winter months when the light is reduced, as well as the plant nutrition as well. So these are the triggering factors that cause them to enter the diapause. This stage really represents the time when it is good to target these colonies, as they are at the smallest populations and before they emerge for spring, and when they're causing the smallest amount of damage to the crop. The native predators are often quite useful for targeting these populations, as it's often in the colder, it's in the winter months when it's cold. So the native predators, which I'll go on to talk about, are more hardier to these colder temperatures and are often able to target these microcolonies within this within diapause, and they're able to emerge out of diapause at the same time. So you can get some really early preventative control in there before before the spider mite colonies have a chance to establish themselves properly within the crop in the spring. So now I'm going to look at the individual biologicals that are available for spider mite control. So these predators are all really effective in creating a good IPM strategy for the control of spider mites. So in this, I'm going to describe how best to apply them and the conditions and timings of application. So within this, I'm going to look at Amblyosis andersoni, Phytoselus, Amblyosis californicus, Macrolophus, and finally Feltiella, and hopefully just unpack some of the information behind these and give you an idea of how you can really utilize these species to create, and as I mentioned, an effective IPM strategy. So starting off with Amblyosis andersoni, so this is a good predator to start off with because it's generally used as a preventative measure early in the spring, as it is native to the UK, so it is more better adapted to our climatic conditions. So as you can see there, the active temperatures are between 6 to 40 degrees, so they also enter dipols, so they can enter dipols around the same time as the spider mites. So when they emerge actually with the with these micro colonies of spider mites, so they can target them really early on in the season. So as soon as the climatic conditions become adequate. So as I said earlier, it's really about targeting the dipols colonies and before they reach the webbing stage. And this species really enables them to give good control early on in the season. It's a generalist predator, so as you can see on the left-hand side, it covers a range of different spider mite species, including various gall mites, and even young thrips as well will feed on. However, it does have a preferred diet of spider mites. It will also feed on pollen and also fungal spores. So it's good if there's a low pest pressure in the crop, it can change its diets to keep itself going through the colder months. If there's not enough spider mite prey about, then it can sustain itself and then move towards the targeting spider mites when they become readily available in the crop. So they're very good for targeting the smaller micro colonies. And also just to mention that they target all growth stages of spider mites. So looking at Phytoselus, this is really the go-to predator for spider mites, as it's a very voracious predator. It targets spider mites specifically, most notably two-spotted spider mites. If you've got a heated environment that stays above 15 degrees, then this is definitely your best option for control straight off. So it's very mobile through the crop, so you can treat hotspot areas, and then once it's good for eradicating these colonies. So once it's used up all of its food source in the environment of spider mites, it will then venture through the crop and target those other colonies that you might not have seen. So it's really good for keeping spider mite at bay through the season. And again, it targets all growth stages of spider mites. Looking at Amblyosis californicus, this is a licensed predator, so it has to be under full. It has to be applied only under full enclosure, so it's not getting out into the wider environment, as it's a non-native predator. It's very useful for activity at higher temperatures, so you're looking to apply this within the warmer months, and it complements itself with Phytoselus. So in the warmer conditions, Phytoselus often moves further down the canopy because it doesn't like the real warm conditions in the hot summer months. So what you'll find is the Phytoselus will stay low in the canopy, so you'll get a good control of the spider mite in that area of the plant. However, in the higher up in the canopy, the spider mites prefer the warm, dry environment, so they will end up thriving higher up in the canopy, Californicus it's better adapted to the warmer environments, will effectively target those colonies in the upper parts of the canopy. So having the two side by side is really a good method of control throughout the plant across the warmer months. Again, it can change its diet, so can respond well to low pest pressure. So it will consume tarsenid mites and also pollen as well until there's a source of spider mites that it can target. So again, its preferred diet is predominantly spider mites. And again, targets all stages of spider mite development. Looking at Macrolophus, so this is again a generalist predator and very useful, a very useful predator. It will target mainly spider mites and whitefly, Tutor absoluta, caterpillars, leaf miner, and aphids. This takes a long time to establish this predator, so early introduction is really key, because once you have them introduced, the good amounts of population, they do offer a really effective control of these pests. So often they're used alongside banker plants. So banker plants are species of plants such as aubergines, which they're more desirable than the crop itself. So they're designed to pull the pests out of the crop, and Macrolophus will actually predate these pests on the banker plants themselves. So, and they will also reproduce. So you can get a really good effective control of the pests on these banker plants themselves. So, but again, the real key thing with this is to introduce them early. So they start, their activity starts around 18 degrees temperature, and it also targets, again, all stages of spider mite development. Finally, Feltiella. This is a gall midge that's very specialised for feeding on spider mites. Its optimum activity is between 20 to 27 degrees. It's effective for when you've got a high pest population, and it's very mobile in the crop as well, especially during the wing stage, where it can travel and seek out those populations of spider mites, and again it targets all stages of spider mite development, so a really effective predator for targeting of spider mites. So finally, I'd like to just say thank you for watching. For any further questions, please chuck us over an email. My email is alex.matthews@fargrove.co.uk, or please feel free to give Biosales an email. The email is biosales@fargrove.co.uk. And just say thank you for listening.